I'm Jeremy Lickness with On.net, and if you are a XAML developer, UWP developer, and you were a fan of XAML Pad, you're going to want to check this out, XAML Studio.
Yep, it's the big new thing.
The big new thing. So rapid prototyping, data binding, debugging, lots of cool features, and you'll have to tune into the show to check them out.
We'll see you there.
Hi, welcome to another episode of On.net. My name is Jeremy Lickness, and I'm here today with Michael Hawker, who has an amazing new application to share with us today. Before we jump into it, this is something that XAML developers are going to be pretty excited about. Michael, why don't you tell me a little bit about what you do with Microsoft, what team you're on, et cetera.
Thanks, Jeremy. Really appreciate being here today. I work on the PAX team, which is Partner Analytics and Essential Experiences. We help with the ISV ecosystem and partners to really enrich their development experience with Windows and Office 365, the whole Microsoft 365 experience.
Okay.
So I've been working with them for a couple of years now in a couple of different capacities. I've also been a core contributor to the Windows Community Toolkit and am ramping up more on taking on some ownership of that.
Great. I actually did a previous episode with the Windows Community Toolkit.
Yeah.
So that's exciting. So my understanding is you had a hackathon two years ago?
Started in the 2017 hackathon that we do every summer here at Microsoft.
Okay, tell me a little bit about what you tackled in that hackathon.
Yeah, so having just started working on the PAX team for a few months back then, some of my developer contacts with just learning, ramping up with UWP is like, whatever happened to XAML Pad, that great tool that we used for WPF development? And I was like, that's a great question. I've been thinking about that too. So I was just really missing that gap of being able to jump in, rapidly prototype something, try out something from the docs, and be able to visualize it and see, interact with it right there on the spot. And so I started with the hackathon just seeing like, hey, is this possible with UWP? And they still had that great API call that let you load XAML. And okay. So I started from there, and it just kind of grew into a much bigger project that we'll get into today.
All right, and the project is called?
XAML Studio. It's okay. Really kind of supposed to be a one-stop shop for this rapid prototyping and iterating on UWP XAML projects.
Okay, great. Well, tell us a little bit more about what it is and how we get started with it.
Yeah, so it's a UWP store app, so you can just go to the Microsoft Store on your Windows 10 machine and download it from the store. So you don't even need Visual Studio installed. You can just get started with UWP XAML development right away.
Okay.
So that's going to be pretty cool and different change. You don't have to wait for Visual Studio to install on a new machine if you want to get started.
Right, you just pull the store app, open it,
yep.
And you're off to the races.
Yeah, I think it's going to be like 100 megs or, pretty small store app compared to, the couple gigs you pull down with Visual Studio usually.
Sure.
And from there, you can just land on the welcome page here. You can start a new file, and it boots up right away, gives you some XAML down here, which is driving this text up here. So Jeremy, what's your favorite color?
Let's go with purple for today.
All right, so I can type in purple here, and then we see the text change up at the top to purple right away.
Okay.
So I can do other things right here, too. I could change this to a stack panel. You can see I've got some IntelliSense there to help me out with that. And then I can add a button in here, too, and give it some content. And now I can actually have this button here. And unlike the Visual Studio or Blend designers, you just kind of see the button in its place on the page. This one's an actual button that I can click on and interact with as if it was in my app. So if I put a text box down here as well, then I can actually type in this thing.
So the thing to call out here is that this is interactive. So I'm seeing what my styling and animations look like when I'm clicking the button. I can see offsets between the button and the text box.
Right.
So you could adjust your padding, your formatting, do all this basically live.
Right, exactly. I can resize the app here if I wanted to, play with how responsive is my app being at the time. So you can really see how your XAML is going to behave in your app live as if it was running without needing to, actually start up your app and wait for it to compile and run. And then, sometimes the live edit and continue doesn't always kind of deal with resources the greatest, and so or you know you change everything in your XAML page, and you know requires you to restart, rebuild your app.
Right, so it can recreate the whole graph.
Exactly.
Okay.
So this is a lot quicker. You mentioned animations, which is a great segue into this. A friend of mine, Justin, had some old Windows Phone Silverlight animations.
Oh, yes. I'm so glad you brought up both Windows Phone and Silverlight. Those are still, that's where I got started in going out and talking about applications and development was
right.
In my Silverlight days. So.
Great. Yeah, I wrote a little puzzle game back originally for Windows Mobile 6.
Okay.
And I ported it over when the phone came out. And so that was just a lot of fun. But then I didn't see any of my users from Mobile 6 pick it up on Windows Phone 7.
Right.
So this is an animation example we had. And so you use some behaviors to have the button here that's actually part of the page in the XAML trigger the animation, and then having another click trigger a secondary animation.
And this is all previewable, basically, in the window here.
Yeah, it's all I could edit this animation. It's pretty large. It has a lot of different resources and things. But I could go in here, make a change, and then automatically just replay the animation and see it update live. So it's a pretty powerful tool, especially for these types of interactive experiences, because you can actually see the result and interact with it and understand that that's going to be how it behaves in your app.
Let me ask you this. It hasn't been forever since I've worked with XAML and WPF and Silverlight. And so XAML is a way of instantiating objects.
Right.
And those objects, most of the time, are related to UI and layout and animation and things to that concept. So we have the code behind, right? The code
Yep.
that drives those. Does this support any type of custom code behind or third-party libraries or anything along
right.
That's a great those lines?
That's a great question. Right now, this is purely dealing with the UI XAML markup itself.
Okay.
It's not dealing with any of the code behind. So I can't, you know, I can use the behavior extensions for XAML to trigger some basic behaviors like starting an animation. But I can't go in and I can say, okay, when I click this button, go, you know, launch some other app or, you know, right.
Well, which really the focus here is to be a rapid prototyping tool, get it exactly where you want
yeah.
it. Then you can bring it into some other
exactly.
IDE to do your hardcore development.
Right. This is really a jumping off point. So, you know, I see an example on docs.microsoft.com. I can copy and paste that in here. I can play with it. I can craft it, nearly make it look and feel like how I want, because I can do that rapid prototyping, and then I can copy it into my project in Visual Studio and hook up all the actual behaviors.
Makes sense.
You mentioned third-party libraries. I do have, for instance, the Windows Community Toolkit. I also have the Telerik open source controls in here, so you can actually use those libraries as part of this as well. So I have some data context here for a chart. So it's just an array of numbers. I can actually go over to this data context panel that I have here, paste that in, and now I have this data live driving my chart that
wow.
I generated with the XAML. And so I could actually update this number here, and we can see the graph change right away.
So what does the data context panel support? I see there's a REST URL, so you can actually call endpoints and pull
yeah.
data back that way.
So I can actually go over, I have a weather example here, so I have this pre-generated link, and this gives us the weather in San Francisco. It's going to go pull down that REST API JSON blob and then drive the weather for San Francisco. So if I put our location in here in Redmond, then it'll go pull the Redmond weather, so it's going to be rainy.
It's basically going to remind us that we're in the middle of winter.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. Although it's actually pretty warm today. 52 degrees is like a heat wave.
Yeah, so. Yeah. You get, especially after the cold spell we've had.
Sure. So you've got this ability to edit a data source. So obviously we can do data binding and look at how stack panels or grids or other things that have repeatable elements would work out. What other tools are available as far as troubleshooting, like how my data bindings work?
Yeah, so data bindings is always kind of one of the tricky parts of XAML development to really kind of pick up on and start to use, and but it really adds a lot of power to your app, being able to have your data model separate from your UI and then
right.
hooking them together. But you know, traditionally in Visual Studio, debugging them, it puts out a little, you know, output line on the the command window when you've got something wrong, and it's a little hard to figure out what's going on. So that was one of the things that really kind of took this from the XAML pad of the past to the XAML Studio, this modern experience in the future, is because I added some helpers to help you debug your bindings.
Okay.
So we can actually see that down here already. I have this binding, and I can see that it's been triggered three times, three different values have passed through because we updated the data context. And the last value was 0.1, which is the one that we see up here in the UI. I can actually go see what other bindings are on this page here. So I can see there's some Sunday night text. This is from all the different list items, but I can click on here and jump into where I can, where I'm getting that binding from. And so I can see the different hits. So it's getting hit so many times because it's a list. So this binding is being triggered for every item in the list.
Right, okay. Yeah, because that's a template that gets repeated basically.
Exactly.
As it renders out, okay.
Yeah. So this gives us a lot of power to really dig in and see what's going on with our bindings in the app. So I have a little, you know, example page that I wrote that has some animations and it has a toggle button. And so I can actually change the mode to history. So every time I toggle the toggle button, we can see this history gets updated with, you know, when it was toggled and what the value was. And if I click on that, it'll take me over to that binding so I can see where that was in my code.
Now on this UI that has the grid mark so we can see positioning and everything.
Yep.
I noticed as you hovered your cursor over it, it highlights different elements. Is there any interactivity between it? Oh, it was actually, that was just the list on the weather app.
Yeah, the list on the weather app. Yeah,
I
had the highlight. Yeah, there's no kind of visual tree picker. You know, that'd be a future feature probably.
Okay.
I have a long backlog of things I'd like to add. But yeah, the grid in the background is actually an option here, so I can turn the grid off if we don't want it. And so now it just gives you the actual color. But it's helpful if you're trying to, you know, line things up and do a little bit more precise padding. You can turn the grid on and adjust all the different sizing and opacity to your liking. There's a bunch of other other features in here too.
So my understanding is this has been a project which started off as a hackathon. It's been kind of some late night coding.
Yeah, nights and weekends.
But it's about to mature and be released as a general tool. Not to put you on the spot, because someone actually has to implement these features.
Right.
But we talked about rapid prototyping. You've got a data source debugger,
yep.
If you will, data binding.
Yep.
Debugger. We've got some flexibility with data sources, which is really nice because I think most of the time when we're writing apps, we're using some sort of web API to hit and bring back
data.
So that works. What are some of the top, I guess, features that you're considering putting into the tool? And again, not as a commitment, but things people might get excited about. Or is it too soon to tell?
Yeah, I mean, right now I've just been working towards getting it out there to the world and everyone. And so that's been, you know, obviously there's a lot of work that goes through just shipping the product. You know, shipping is a feature in itself.
Sure.
And the garage has been great at helping me, you know, get these final little check marks out and pushing it through. And so that's just been the exciting piece for me. But in the meantime, I have that backlog of features that I do want to implement in the future. Like we kind of mentioned, you know, being able to look at more of the visual tree like you can in Visual Studio. That would be one of, you know, one of the ones up there. Got some other pie in the sky things to look at too. Just kind of helping out with some of the existing experiences, you know, configuring, you know, if you want your editor on the top or the side, some of those things. We did some great samples recently with the tab view that's from the Windows Community Toolkit, so probably some improvements there.
That's the irony of this tool that I'm laughing about, because this is a UWP app that uses XAML to allow you to prototype a UWP app with XAML. So it's a little bit of inception going on.
Exactly.
So I had two other questions that came to mind while you were talking to me. First is, in case someone watching this isn't familiar with it, you mentioned the garage. What is the garage?
The garage is basically kind of a maker-hacker space for Microsoft employees to kind of aggregate, come together, get resources for their own passionate personal kind of side projects, you know, beyond what they're doing during their day job. So, you know, I'm fortunate that this is kind of aligns a lot with what I'm doing in my day job, but it's still something that I've just been working, you know, nights and weekends slowly over the last year and a half.
So the garage is a place where you can host content, find people to help out, do some things like that, and vet it basically before you release it out to the wild.
Exactly. They have a lot of resources. They have a whole space on campus where people can go, and they have like laser woodcutters and 3D printers. So if people want to build things physically on robots, they can do that and meet other people that are trying to do that, come together. Or it can be someone like me with an app and an idea, and they just need help. You know, how do I get this from this hackathon, you know, passion project to the world?
Right. I'm sure what I would hack together over a weekend that works for me is a far cry from what would be released as a polished professional product.
Yeah. Those nitpicky little details, all the things that you don't think about when you're hacking a prototype on the weekend, they add up in a lot of time and effort, but it really makes a big difference.
Okay, so the next question might be a dumb question where I'm showing my age because I haven't worked on XAML recently. Is there still a Visual State Manager?
There is.
XAML? There is.
Yep.
And is that something that this tool supports?
So yes, with the behavior, that's kind of how this animation gets triggered in a way. Well, this is using more of a storyboard, but it's a similar concept. Like this button has a behavior attached to it to trigger the storyboard to cause this animation to play initially. And so you can do similar sort of things with the Visual State Manager, and that's probably an area that I want to improve on in the future, is having a little bit more insight.
So I'm basically creating work for you now by mentioning this. And so my understanding is this is close to being released. By the time someone's watching this, it should be out there, available, ready to go.
That's the plan.
We'll put a link up so that people can get to it and download it. Is there anything else you wanted to share that we haven't touched upon?
We haven't really touched on this other icon over here. This is the toolbox. It lets you quickly kind of search for tools. So if I need a grid, I could pull that up. Of course, now that fails.
Well, it's because we're live.
Yeah, so. There we go.
So,
I think I have
issue number 497, yeah. Case sensitive.
Case sensitive. There we go. I'm so used to typing it in XAML, I'm always typing with the capital letter, I guess. So I'll have to fix that quick.
Sure.
But yeah. So now I can see all the different types of grids, and I can even see the ones from the toolkit. So like, there's the uniform grid we added earlier this year as another WPF compat for UWP. So we've got a lot of those in the toolkit. So if you're moving from WPF to UWP, there's a lot of different great resources out there and controls to help you use the ones that you're still using.
So I see each of these has a link into docs too. So this is...
Yeah, so if I want to know more about the uniform grid, I can click on docs. It'll jump me in there, give me the resources there that I need and what it all does and how to use it in the samples. So I could even copy one of these samples out here and... doing a live demo, right?
Right. What could possibly go wrong?
Yeah. So I put that in there, and then we've got the uniform grid from the sample.
Nice.
Right there. So it's pretty exciting to see how it all comes together.
Great. Well, this looks like an incredible tool, so I'll definitely look for that when it comes out. And again, we'll post the show links and everything else. But thank you so much for coming out and
Thanks,
sharing
Jeremy.
This with us.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate you.